neighborhoods in our city have borne the mark of recent events like downtown. Whether it was the vacancy brought on by quarantine at the height of the pandemic, or the uproar that took over streets in the wake of protests in May, or the presence of our homeless population that has been crowded out of shelters due to capacity restrictions, nobody needs to tell them downtown has faced many tough challenges in these last 5 months. But we're on the way back. Indianapolis has a history of being a resilient city, and we can overcome any challenge that we are presented by working together collaboratively, public and private partnership, as Indianapolis has always had. That's why we've pumped an unprecedented amount of funding and resources into the rehabilitation of our city's economic.
The downtown. $37 million
for business and nonprofits affected by the pandemic. Road closures, allowing business to safely welcome paying customers. $2 million to secure hotel capacity for those of our neighbors who are experiencing homelessness. $2.7 million in emergency solution grants for rapid rehousing, with $7 million more coming at the end of this month. An expansion to our pathway to employment programs, connecting jobs to those who are homeless or resorting to panhandling. Added DPW cleaning crews to combat increased littering. Added public restrooms and hand washing stations throughout the downtown. All of this and more to assist the pride of Indianapolis. But I will say this as well. I work downtown too, and I'm often here 6 or even 7 days a week. So I know there is still work, much work, to be done. That's why I'm proud that the city of Indianapolis will contribute $750,000 from the downtown TIF to assist in the reopening and recovery efforts focused in and around our Mile Square. This investment will mean a bolstered public safety infrastructure day and night for downtown. It will mean an increased investment in non-public safety personnel to serve as wayfinders and ambassadors, something many of you will recall was quite effective when we hosted the Super Bowl years ago. It means new technology capabilities to help our law enforcement personnel better assess and better respond in real time to illegal activity. And it comes in the form of more cleaning capacity for our common areas, more homeless outreach for effective and people-first solutions. So I want to thank the Downtown Recovery Committee and all at Downtown Indy and the Capital Improvement Board who have worked to develop this coordinated, comprehensive response. This is what can be accomplished when our city works together. But even after today's investment, this work is not done. The pandemic, which is one of the greatest threats our city has ever faced, will require an ongoing and unprecedented response. This city has my pledge that we will never stop working to repair the damage the pandemic has brought to our downtown. And as long as we have partners like the ones joining us today, I know we will prevail. Tomorrow will be better than today. And each and every week and month hereafter, our city is on its way back. Now I'm very proud to introduce Sherry, the downtown Indy president, dear friend, and a leader in this effort. Sherry, thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. We really appreciate all that you've done during these challenging times. I want to thank you on behalf of the Downtown Indy, Inc. Board of Directors, as well as the members of our Downtown Recovery Committee. Our co-chair, one of our co-chairs is here, Mr. Tom McGowan. I'm also joined by Deputy Chief Barker, who is one of our co-chairs of the Subcommittee on Safety. As the mayor had mentioned, downtown has continued to struggle, and we face many challenges. We haven't had our workforce in downtown. On a normal day, we have roughly 155,000 workers in our downtown footprint. Currently, we have maybe 10 to 15% that have come back to their offices. We also don't have the events that we are accustomed to. Chris Gall, I believe, said normally we have an additional 50 to 60,000 visitors walking our downtown sidewalks. And so with the absence of those folks in downtown, we're really dependent on residents to really support a lot of our retailers and our downtown restaurants. But today, we feel confident in our announcement that will help strengthen our downtown and find its way back. So earlier this summer, Downtown Indy, Inc. formed the Downtown Recovery Committee to spur economic sustainability, business, and civic leaders representing businesses large, small, private, nonprofit, have all joined together to outline a plan for downtown to move forward. There, as I mentioned, the Downtown Recovery Committee is co-chaired by Mr. Tom McGowan with Kite Realty Trust, as well as Mr. Lacey Johnson, who was unable to be here. Lacey is a partner with Ice Miller. Since being formed, Tom and Lacey have assembled an aggressive framework in collaboration with our board, our civic partners, certainly the mayor's office, and the City County Council. The Recovery Committee was formed around critical pillars that include both immediate and longer-term strategies, such as addressing safety, especially in high pedestrian areas, focusing on cleaning and beautification efforts, adding new events, and I hope you will all join us tomorrow on Monument Circle when we launch our new downtown arts market, which will occur every Thursday for the next three Thursdays. Certainly reinvigorating storefronts, as well as incorporating opportunities for Black-owned businesses, mitigating panhandling, and getting those who are experiencing homelessness housed. And finally, changing the narrative that downtown is safe and vibrant, with many great opportunities for shopping, dining, and outdoor activities. But we know that our market, we know that we can't market our way out of this. And so to increase the real and perceived concerns about safety, which brings us to our announcement today. The funding from our city to address public safety first will specifically go to increased foot and bike patrol. Our organization currently employs off-duty officers that bike and walk around downtown, but this will certainly at least quadruple the number of hours that they spend on our downtown sidewalks. We'll be launching the Downtown Indy, Inc.'s Safety Ambassador Program, which will employ civilians and IMPD cadets who will assist downtown patrons and business owners while serving as extra eyes and ears throughout the Miles Square. The safety ambassadors will provide daytime and evening coverage with direct communication to IMPD. So they will be radioed directly to IMPD if they see something. They will, in fact, be able to say something. Creating a network of 150 street-level cameras in partnership with Miles Square businesses, which will be part of IMPD's existing B-Link program. And we can certainly talk a little bit more about how that will work. Additionally, we'll add mobile cameras positioned in crime hotspots that will be monitored by IMPD. These are larger trailer cams that are able to move around to different locations. These funds will immediately be put to good use, and our message is clear. Downtown is open for business. We want to do everything we can to encourage our community to rally and support downtown restaurants, retailers, and attractions. And I encourage those who seek to help support our downtown, please go to our website at downtownindy.org and seek out the Buy Now so you can find the restaurants that are open, that you can purchase gift cards now and use them later. If not, continue to help support them by carrying out your dinner, your lunch. Again, I want to thank the Recovery Committee, who remains incredibly focused on addressing these additional areas needing immediate response. We will continue to seek additional funding to augment the outreach to the unhoused, enhance cleanliness and trash removal and beautification, and activate our downtown and reshape the narrative that downtown is ready for your business. Thank you all for coming, and we will certainly take questions and answers. Or we'll take questions, we'll try and provide answers. Yes. Deputy Chief Barker is going to kill me when I pull him up here, but I'm going to do it anyway. So.
Yeah, great question. Look, we're familiar with it. We're as frustrated, I think, as you are and the Circle business owners are. I think one of the benefits of us expanding our capability with the foot and bike patrols is, you know, downtown district has finite resources, and we are trying to address those issues in as real time as possible as those kind of high complaint areas identify themselves. And I would say that it's not even just exclusive to Monument Circle. City Market, Wabash Street, Georgia Street, there are locations that we're consistently taking those complaints in. To the best of our ability at this point, we're trying to use the critical capabilities that we have built into downtown district's assignment, as well as other areas within the agency that specialize in the narcotics trafficking complaints, to address those issues and try to make an impact. Understanding that, you know, there's some aspects of those complaints that we can control. There's other aspects that fall in different places within the criminal justice system. To circle back, I think that the benefit of quadrupling the hours available to the off-duty employment is, you know, we've talked about it for a long time. One thing that we do, it remains a challenge, is stationary and consistent presence in areas, because we have to be responsive to the calls as they come in real time. So this will offer us an opportunity to have officers on foot, on bike, you know, as well as modifying you know, some of those on-duty resource deployments to have a more consistent presence in places like the Circle, where they're not just, you know, I'm gonna show up and then I'm gonna catch another call in progress and have to leave again. This is gonna give us the opportunity to have a more sustainable system of patrol in the downtown square.
Yeah, I would simply respond by saying I'll readily admit I have not talked to every single downtown business owner, but I have had many conversations with downtown businesses. In fact, Chief Barker and I have been on a circuit to talk with restaurant and other businesses throughout the downtown area. So. If there are business owners that I have not had the opportunity to talk with, I certainly am open to that. But we have had a lot of conversations with business owners. I've heard their complaints. In fact, one business owner stopped me as we were coming into today's press conference, whose business is right across the street, and expressed to me some concerns that he had about essentially our unhoused population and their Georgia Street presence. So I've heard them, and in no small measure today is I hope a very, very big step forward in addressing some of those concerns. Well, first of all, it's important to understand that in the months of March and April, and frankly, into the summer months as well, we as a city and as a community have been overwhelmed with just responding to the spread of the virus, to its effect, the deaths that it has caused. And as a result, I will readily admit that a lot of our attention has been focused on issues that affect the city as well as the downtown, but all areas of the city. Today, we are announcing, thanks to the committee that Downtown Indy has put together, those steps that will focus exclusively on our downtown. And but as mayor, you know, I'm not just the mayor of downtown, I'm the mayor of the entire community. And a lot of our focus has been on other neighborhoods as well. No neighborhood is safer, no neighborhood is more important than downtown. And to echo what Sherry observed, part of the challenge that downtown has faced is a lack of population in terms of people coming downtown to work. And as that momentum returns, I think you'll see a fundamental change in many aspects of the downtown way of life.
This is your question, how are we integrating the downtown residents into the solutions? So we do have, the committee is currently made up of roughly 30 members. They make up large corporations, small corporations. You know, if you think of all the industries that represent downtown, we've identified individuals that represent many of those areas, including residents. So we do have two, if not three, downtown residents represented, so almost, you know, a tenth of the participants are downtown residents. So we do hear their voice strongly. Does that answer your question? Well, I mean, if you think about, again, this is an initial step on the safety side, but if you have a number of off-duty officers walking and biking on around downtown, the new employment of safety patrol, who are again radioed directly to IMPD, plus 150 external new cameras placed on properties, residential and commercial, in and around downtown that are directly linked to IMPD, I think that certainly benefits our downtown residents.
Very quickly, sorry, one more speaker to add into the mix as we look at recovery as holistically. Good afternoon, my name is Chris Gall, Senior Vice President with Visit Indy. Thank you, Andy, for hosting us. Welcome to the Indiana Convention Center. Welcome to Downtown Indy. Those are phrases that we've been using much more than you may think. Over a 40-day period measured from July 7th through August 16th, Indianapolis has proudly hosted 18 events and meetings, bringing in 40,000 visitors to our great city. That tallies more than $20 million in economic impact. In addition to that, we've been welcoming visitors on the leisure front as part of the $1 million advertising campaign that Mayor Hogsett helped put in place through federal CARES Act money. Over the same time period, we have generated $667,000 in visitor spending. So over the last 40 days, you might find it surprising that this city, Indianapolis, has welcomed, again, 18 events and thousands of people into our downtown. And when we go out and talk to our counterparts and other tourism agencies around the country, that is an anomaly, that we're still hosting events. And that's in large part to the commitment to our downtown, the $7 million in upgrades that have been put in place through the Capital Improvement Board into this building. And so from a tourism perspective, we're very, very grateful that Mayor Hogsett and the administration, but moreover, Team Indy, continues to invest in our downtown because it is our biggest attractant when we look to drive tourism. Thank you. We'll take some additional questions.
Currently, our budget is annualized, so we have sufficient resources for 1 year. That's the next step. And so after this press announcement, we will start soliciting different property owners who will want to have those cameras placed on their property. They will, the cameras will be paid for, but they will be asked to pay a $20 fee just to be linked to the cloud on a monthly basis.
Please. Yeah, so I think the beauty of the B-Link element of this plan is that the B-Link is not, there's no bookend necessarily. We recognize, and just so everybody's clear, it's not necessarily just 150 cameras. We're looking at a funding opportunity for 150 locations that could have multiple cameras on that location. And just as a reminder, B-Link is the private public partnership that IMPD has through our Indy Public Safety Foundation that allows business owners and residents, to the question about residents, to incorporate their either existing camera technology or new camera technology with IMPD's Incident Analysis Center, or IAC. We have at blinkindy.org gives some of the specific information as it regards to the technology that's used. But essentially, you have two options where B-Link can either recommend to you the types of cameras and solution that immediately integrates within to the existing B-Link platform, or what we see a lot downtown is there are several businesses that already have very robust security and camera systems in place. There's also an on-prem solution that allows us to incorporate hard drives uploaded into the cloud so that that robust camera system can be incorporated into the B-Link platform. The benefit to the downtown businesses and residents is there is some capability, though it's limited to shift work at this point, where we have the capability and personnel in the Incident Analysis Center to monitor those cameras in real time. But the larger benefit, I think, that speaks to B-Link's success is, right now one of the common frustrations that we run across is, you know, our great officers downtown who are doing a phenomenal job at trying to police the issues sort of in this COVID vacuum in the downtown area. They're very responsive to those calls for service and that we receive hundreds of times a day. What we run into, though, is a lot of times, you know, it's a crime in progress. We get there, the suspect has already fled the scene, and we may encounter a business that caught a part of or all of that crime on camera. Oftentimes, it's very difficult for us to get that camera footage quickly and be able to disperse that to the officers in the area or throughout the rest of the department, for that matter, because oftentimes it happens after hours where there's no manager available, or the people who have the purview over recording that video and getting it to one of our investigating detectives, it's just time prohibitive. B-Link cuts out that middleman and allows us to circumvent that wait to where if a partner, a business, or a resident incorporates their camera systems into the B-Link program, our specialists out at the IAC can immediately access that. They can get critical information that could be captured on that video, suspect description, vehicles, license plates, what have you, and get that almost immediately to the officers. The other benefit is if we think that there is some sort of incident that kicks off in the downtown area or in an area involving B-Link cameras, we have a real-time map at that IAC that shows us, okay, if this incident is dispatched, I have an overlay of what our B-Link camera map is, and I can see in real time, hey, there's a business with a camera here, so this is the camera that I need to start looking for to see if they've captured any of that crime in progress to help us be more responsive from a patrol perspective.